sing together do. Tests and trials, love renew. Yeah, we've made it. We've always been proven true. We've always been proven true. Still the world that tries to steal our hope, tries to make us numb, but our love has overcome. And you, my dear, you are my prize. When I look into your eyes, love overflow, I'm never letting go. Each other.
Good Friday outreach. This Friday, we're having an activity here on campus. We had it last year. We had men reenacting being on the cross out front. You can already see the crosses out there. It was a tremendous opportunity. Highway 80 was honking and blaring and slowing down, and we had to have a police person out there. I mean, it was tremendous. So we need volunteers to help with that, to help be, we have people holding signs that say different things. We have people passing out snacks. We have people praying with people. People pull up and want to take closer pictures, and we have people talking to them. So please sign up at the table out there to let us know that you can come and help us with that Friday. It is from 2 to 6 on Friday afternoon. Baptism sign up is still out there. The shirts have been ordered. We ordered some extras, so hopefully you fit the size that we got extras of. But we would still like to know that you would like to participate, and we can have a certificate ready, and we can just be better prepared. So sign up out there at the table. And then Pastor's going to talk more about this, but I said last week we have no service Wednesday, but this is going to be a service Wednesday. So he'll tell you more later. Let's stand up, folks. Let's stand up and let's worship.
Father, we thank you for being with us this morning, God. We lift up Christy to you. God, we lift up her mom as she just left to go and be with her. We just pray for your presence to surround them. God, we invite you into this service this morning. We need you here, God. We love you, Jesus. We want you with us. Holy Spirit, I pray you give us peaceful minds. Give us the mind of Christ. Give us pure hearts, God, in Jesus' name.
Louder than the other.
you've even gone when my word come back with the hand of my enemy. Come back and you call it my victory. Go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. Your love becomes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness.
Fear that gripped my heart is arrested.
Because you finish what you start, I will trust you in the process. I believe you, God. You know, the Lord has a funny way of wanting things up today. How many of y'all are trusting the process right now? You've been in the middle of a war. You're fighting. You don't even have to fight it. Because he's already there in the middle of it. He set the table already before you in the presence of your enemies already. You know, he's already set the table. He's already gone before you, and he's already paddled. So tired of trying to fight, not trusting God in the fight. Because I only see part of it. I don't see the big picture. How small-minded are we that we don't see the big picture that God's trying to put before us? So, when I only see in part, I will prophesy your promise. I believe you, God, because you finish what you start. I will trust you in the process, and I believe. I mean, I will speak what your promise is. Instead, I will speak to that and say, no, this is what the Lord promised me. This is what the word says. I'm going to prophesy that word, that promise that he gave me over my life. I'm going to take my blinders off and I'm going to trust the process.
Promise, I believe you, God. atmosphere is changing. Nothing stays the same. Heaven is waiting for the mention of your name. The Spirit is moving. It's burning like a
yeah. The atmosphere is changing. I want to live in a lifestyle that nothing can stay the same. The atmosphere. Every time we sing that song, I can just feel it. I remember the first time the Lord ever touched me, and the atmosphere was changing. And ever since that day, Robbie, nothing's ever been the same. I've had tough days and tough moments and walked through things in my life, but the atmosphere changed. When He invades your life, nothing stays the same. Your attitude, what you watch, what you talk. I'm not talking about a moment or a day or I was, you know, I caught myself. I don't know what I was doing. I'm talking about nothing stays the same. You can't live in an atmosphere that don't look like Him. There's no comfort in that place. Say that one more time, Laura. Sing that. The atmosphere is changing. Come on. You feel that? Come on. Heaven is waiting at the mention of His name.
Your spirit is moving. It's burning like a flame. Healing the broken.
At what? At the pound? At the just the mention of His name.
Raise it up. Feel the sky. Oh, chains will fall.
What name is it? I know you know the reason for this season. And I want to just tell you, some transforming power in your life will happen if you mention His name. I was a youth pastor for years, and I used to tell the youth group, because you know young people like to date and find themselves sometimes in difficult situations and at parties or whatever. And I used to say, in the middle of whatever mess that you're in, because it would always be some reason why I didn't know. I said, in the middle of whatever mess that you're in, just say His name. I'm just telling you, if you're watching a movie and they begin to use profanity, it makes you just cringe a little bit. Mention His name. I promise you, you will grab that remote and you'll cut it off. You can't mix them. If something in you begins to shake a little bit, and I used to tell them, I don't care how good he looks or how good she looks. In the middle of the date, just mention His name. Watch what happens. You don't have to preach. You got to come out with a verse. Just mention His name. Just say, hey, why are we riding? I just wanted to say, Jesus. Hey, why you want to hold my hand? I just want to say, Jesus. I'm just telling you, something would happen. And so the teenagers would always, boys, some of the boys hated me because, you know, they'd be easing in. And I know their game because I had one. And I would say, if that guy or that girl, I would always pick on the guys. I'd say, if that guy is taking you on a date, when he picks you up, and I'd say, just challenge him, just say, has the Lord talked to you today? Have you talked to Him? I promise you, the atmosphere of that date will shift. That his whole plans would be like, oh, man, let's just get a to-go box. You know what I mean? We're just going to go buy McDonald's. You know what I mean? The whole dining and, you know, other things may change. And so I want us just, in the middle of this season, let's remember His name. The Bible says there's power just in His name. That don't sound right. I was telling the Bible study this morning, what we've lost in America is the mystical wonder of Jesus. It seems wild and crazy and don't make sense that I could just mention His name. And at the very mention of His name, strongholds would be broken. But I guarantee you it's true. There's people in this room right now that fought their life to be free. And just the mention of His name one day, just one time, you may have walked in this service, you may have been in your car, but let me just tell you something. It ain't me mentioning His name. It's you mentioning His name. When you begin to cry out, Jesus, help me. Jesus, save me. Jesus, keep me. Jesus, lead me. The atmosphere changes. Us together say amen. Amen. Thank you, worship team. I want to, hey, as they're coming down, will you tell them thank you? Thank you for what you do. I want to tell you, nobody on this worship team gets paid. We give them love gifts once or twice a year. Nobody asks for it. They serve because they love Jesus and they love you and they love this church. And so they come early. They usually stay late. They are putting together equipment or picking things up or plugging things up. And sometimes we don't know what button does what. And we can't hear something in our ear and this speaker ain't working. And they just keep worshiping. So I want to read you a scripture. So I have like three messages because I hadn't spoke in a while. And so it's complicated. But I want to start out with a little bit of business. And I'm going to say, read this scripture, and then I want you to think about you, not your friend, not your neighbor, not your girlfriend, not your other friend, not your last friend. I want you to think about you, and then I want to just talk a little bit about what God's done, and then we're going to get into the message. So this is pre-message, and this don't count against my time, okay? So 1 Corinthians chapter 12, I'm going to read you a couple verses. Now, there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And now I know these are different verses in your Bible, but this is the same sentence. You know what I love about the Bible is it's not grammatically correct. There's run-on sentences, there's commas, there's, you know, that's where I learned my writing from. You know what I mean? Felicia, that's where I got my education from. And there are a variety of services, but the same Lord. And there are a variety of activities, but in the same power, God's power, that move in them in each one. So let's read that again. There are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are a variety of services, but the same Lord. There are a variety of activities, but it is the same God whom empowers them in every one. So I wanted to read that because I want you to think about you. And I'm gonna give God some praise. And maybe mix a little rant in with it, okay? Let me tell you what I don't like about church. I do not like spectator mentality. That don't mean I don't like you. I love you. I just might not like your mentality. I don't like, and it's not Church on the Rock. I'm talking about church, Christianity as a whole, that we believe, and it's mostly America, but that we believe that it's you come to church, see what we can do for you, and then you'll figure out if this is where you want to be or not. It's a consumer mindset that we think that this thing is built for you. We understand that the temple and this tabernacle and this building was built to worship Him. But just take you for an example, not your neighbor, not your friend, not your husband. Take you for an example. When you come here, most of the time, you expect to be served. Don't navel gaze. Don't. I'm not talking about beat yourself up. Just look at you. This whole thing is set up for Him. This whole thing. And we, me being one, as the church in America, we have set this thing up to where when you come in, and we will serve you. That's what we're called to do. Serve one another. Love one another. Cherish one another. Take care of one another. Help one another. Whatever. But what we don't want is for you to believe that church is just about you. I hope they sing my song. I hope they use this verse. I hope they don't go long. I hope we have a prayer. I hope we do this. I hope my child gets this. If they don't give them a paper, if they don't do this, if this don't happen, we need more room. We need more seats. It's too cold. I'm going to bring a jacket. I don't like this. Whatever. I've been there. But let me just tell you, the atmosphere is changing. I can feel a shift in this room to where I used to say this at the beginning of the church, because when I first found, when people, we first started coming, that people were just coming and coming, and people was just like sitting on their hands. Just come in and sitting on their hands. And so I used to, our saying used to be, this is a hospital, then this becomes a family, and then this becomes an army. And we used to say that all the time. We used to say all the time that you come in here, most of the time you're broken. Some of you's got a broke pinky, but most of you have more broken bones than one. And so most of the time it was like an emergency room. You run in. It ain't, and this, we didn't want our emergency room to be like other emergency rooms. You know what I mean? Like, I hear now, I hadn't been to the emergency room. Thank you, Jesus. I told my wife the other day, I said, if I have to go to the emergency room, unless I can't breathe, take me to Birmingham. Because the most emergency rooms are not an emergency room. It's set over there, we'll get to you in about 8 hours. You know what I mean? But we didn't want to serve like that. We wanted to be the kind of emergency room when you came in, we began to help you, nourish around you, not fix you, not repair you. Some people don't stay because they're like, I thought you was going to fix everything. And you was like, no. We just wanted to guide you to the one that could. We just wanted to, you know, get close enough to know that he's done something miraculous in our life. What a lot of people want to do is you're their next leech. You're the leech, and they want to, is the minute you come out to try to help them, they leech onto you. Save me, help me. But we wanted to be able to come close enough that we could love on you and show you, hey, he's transformed my life. And then you would see that. And as you got close, we'd become a family. And after a couple of weeks, months, depends on how many broken bones you had, when you become part of that family, we would put a uniform on you and put you in the army. And then we expected you to stand beside us and put your uniform on and get ready to fight. And that took that church until here, to where we are today. And what I want to say to you, if you're just coming in the last few months and you kind of just caught on to the glory, the little bit of cloud we've been riding on, that happened because of that. So if you just come in and out, don't keep doing that. Today's first steps and next steps, go down there. They'll have a snack, a drink, a cracker, a cookie, or a peanut or something. They're going to talk to you a little bit about, a little bit. It won't be like me. They don't even let me go down there most of the time. But they're going to talk to you a moment about how much that they love you and what this church kind of stands for and who we are. And I've seen people do both classes in 1 week because this one went kind of short, or one, the way it played out, they could do both. They've been here for a while. The next time you come, they're going to tell you, hey, here's some ministry opportunities that are available. Let me just tell you, if we don't know you, you probably ain't going right into children's church. Don't be offended. We cherish that building and that room down there, and you don't just get a ticket in because you said amen. Okay? Well, I don't care who you are, myself included, you will have a background check run, a national background check run before you. And listen, there's some people we just have to say, hey, there's men's ministries, you know what I mean? There's other things, you know, but not right now, or not this way. And then, but listen, there's ministries available. So the second step, they're going to roll out some things. Hey, this, that. You wouldn't believe, if you get here at 9:30 in the morning, there's a wonderful breakfast every week. You wouldn't believe this, but there ain't but 3 or 4 people that share that responsibility. That don't seem right, does it? That 70 or 80 feet people get fed every week. A donut, a snack, a grit, an egg, or whatever the case may be. Sometimes they got biscuit and gravy. I mean, sometimes I want to just sit in there and eat. You know what I mean? I'm like, God, can I just read my Bible later and go eat? But that team should be a little bigger. But there's ministry opportunities, and so you may want to serve on the kitchen team. There's benevolence teams that when funerals happen, there's groups of people that don't work all day or can take days off, and they come in and we serve family. They'll roll them things out. And what we're doing, and when we're saying that, them are invitations to serve, to get in. We're asking you, come get closer, come get closer. I'm saying all this, and I know it's the week before Easter, because when the influx of people begin to come, and it happens around Easter, I know spring break found funny, and the services have been down by numbers, but there'll be some people because of His power this week coming. He, not just you, He wants to use you, but He will start roaming this land. And He will draw people into churches and sanctuaries all across this city, this nation, this country, this earth, because His power. The mention of His name will be mentioned. There'll be more signs up and billboards, and He will draw people in. When they come here, we want them to see, and we need you serving. Now, I told you a few minutes ago, it's not just about what we can do for you, but what I will tell you is, if God begins to use you in ministry opportunities, whether it's handing out cups, sweeping up the floor, whatever. I mean, just think, sorry, I'm not, in whatever ways that He decides to use you. Right here, your Bible says that there's a variety of gifts. I want to read to the very next verse. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. I'm challenging you, because this church, we're at a place to where now it's just not about 45 people being baptized. We want to disciple the 45. I'm just going to be honest with you. The first few years we had church, there was about 6 of us that had a Bible. We were baptizing people. We'd have baptism with 45 people, because God answered my prayer. I said, God, I don't want anybody that goes to any other church. I want to take this sin out of Sin City and bring them in here. And He did. After a few months, maybe a year, I said, God, if there is a Sunday school teacher that's available, and they walk by, dear Jesus, please, if somebody even has a Bible, God, please send them this way. I'm being a little dramatic, but we've seen influx of people getting saved and transformed and renewed. And now that's the core of our church. The core of our church are people that have been transformed. Well, that's all of us. But most of our people that serve here are people that once maybe didn't serve somewhere else, or never done this in this capacity, or I've never done that. I've never seen myself doing this. I never thought I could do this. And now they're in a place and God's using them that way. And I want to tell you that this is the manifestation of the power of the Spirit. Don't discredit your gift. All right? Don't believe because God, you may feel called, that you need this. Most people back up and backpedal because they think, oh, well, they're going to make me, they're going to get me. No, we're not going to make you or get you, kind of not make you or get you. We're not going to forcefully. All right. We won't be physical, okay? It won't be physical for sure. I promise you. It won't be physical. We've never physically, but we do other things. But we won't physically make you do anything. But if there's a draw inside of you, do not discredit you. Because there is a Spirit inside of you, and the manifestation of that is God provoking you to do something for Him. All right? That's my mini sermon that didn't count. Okay? Now I want to tell you something. Our fundraiser over the last 6 weeks, and then I've been out pretty much too, so we didn't really celebrate it. Our fundraiser raised $188,000. So that happened through you. That's why I'm telling you, there's an atmosphere that's changing. Something's happening. Can I tell you why? I'm just going to tell you this, because we're family. And if you don't get this, if you don't hear this, you may not get it. This church has not been known as big tithe givers, big money givers. Now, if we bring a need before you, if I bring a kid or some kids, or a school, or a problem, or an issue, or a family, or whatever, we're in. We're all in. But just the faithful, routine giving every week that the Bible talks about, bring your first fruits. Some of you may not even know what that is. You think that's what the Rock Academy does on Monday morning. No. First fruits is the first that you have, the first minute you wake up, the first dollar that you make, the first time that you have, the first of everything that you have goes to God. If you give Him your first, He blesses the rest. Okay? It's the gift. It's the ministry of first. And so most of us, some of us in this room, I won't say probably most, I don't look and I didn't look at who gave and how much they gave or when they gave. Some of that money's probably still pledged out. I'm not sure that we physically have every dollar of it, but that's what's committed and we stand on that. I believe that the people in this room, if you said, hey, I'm giving $25, it's going to take me 2 weeks, I'm going to do $12.50 at the time, then you're going to do it. But this, guys, is the manifestation of the Spirit. This is the power of God working through you. I'm telling you, I told our leader team the last few months, I said, if this church gets giving faithfully, not just in a need, not just, well, I'm going to get, and I know some of you are good-hearted people, and you think, well, it's my money. If God give it to me, I'll put it where I want to. That's not the way the Bible draws it out. Your time, your first time, and your first fruits goes to Him, the kingdom. So, and you don't get to just appropriate that ever how you want to. It's go to Him, and He tells you. If we get that as a church, if we begin to give like this, and I'm not talking about we're going to raise that kind of money every 6 weeks. That's not the goal. The goal is for you. What I wanted you to see above everything is the miracle power working of God. Most of the time in a 6 week span, we take in about $30,000, AJ, probably. It's about $5,000 a week. We pretty much pay the bills. It costs a lot. Nobody here pays for breakfast when they come. Nobody here pays for their kids getting snacks, curriculum that their kids do. Just the curriculum we use down there is about $6,000 or $7,000 a year. Just for the kids to have curriculum down there where they get printouts and get the things that they do. You wouldn't believe the amount of toilet paper we go through in this place. The water bill, the power bills, $2,000 or $3,000 a month. It's amazing what it costs to run a building. But think about 300 or 400 people in there. I mean, the numbers are about right. But typically, it's about it would have been about $30,000, maybe $35,000 in 6 weeks. We raised $188,000. Some of you stepped out. I don't know who it was. It may have been one of you, two of you, four of you. But some of you stepped out and did more and gave more than you ever have. And some of you, I want you to hear that type of miracle. $150,000 extra came in above what we would have just normally took in because of your faith. Now, I'm not the guy that ever preaches on give, give, give. I want you to see the miracle working power. When we started this, I said the one thing I want for our church to see is not the building, not the stand, the balcony, not these things, these pillars right here we built, not the flooring, not the chairs, not the parking lot that we're going to do. That's not what I want them to see. I want them to see the power that's in their hand. If you learn to give what God does with what you give, and I'm not talking about these things. I'm talking about inside of you. I'm going to promise you this. There's somebody in this room right now that you gave or you've been compelled to give. And when you've done it, you felt freer than you ever have. And since then, God's done something inside of you, your family, your finances, something in your home, something in your heart, something in your mind. You begin to see a release to say, that no longer holds me. I don't know if you realize this, but money is captivating. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. You would be shocked at how much a dollar will hold somebody back and absolutely control them. Absolutely control them. If not, if you don't believe so, watch what a man will do for a dollar. He'll commit a place that, and I'm not going to get into finances, but, anyway, that's ain't a finance class, but I could teach you something on working 8 hours for a certain amount of pay. That's a whole deal. But if a man will give his life, and I'm not talking about work. I know you need to work. But if you work and that work controls you, that is a controlling, and you think that every bit of this money, I got to hold it because I gave 40 hours this week and I don't know if I'll have it next week. Man, that is a controlling bondage that is unbelievable. That the minute that you get freed from that, the Bible says that he can flow through you, he'll get to you. Most of us don't believe this because if you've never given, that I can give more and get more. And the more that I give, the more that I get. That's a true statement. All right? So, that's what you've done. That's what you've done. So, in preparation of that, I wanted to tell you a couple things. Today, after service, if some of you men, and I know some women rode with their men, and so we need you to help us just by kissing him on the cheek after service and saying, "Baby, that would be sweet for you to do. I'll go get us a sandwich." But if some of you men would help us get these 300 chairs in that fellowship area, it would be amazing. It would be amazing. If not, three or four of us will have to do it, and it takes a minute. And then Wednesday, we're going to move 600 chairs three times. Woo! Glory to God. Hallelujah. The Spirit of God just fell on nobody. We're going to move 600 chairs three times. I know that sounds like insanity. I feel like it's insanity, but it has to be done. Them 300 chairs that we put out there, 300 more are coming. These 300, 100 of them is going up there. 200 of them is going back on the truck. The 300 is coming off the truck and getting set up in here. The 300 that came out of here is going to another building and getting unloaded. Let me read this scripture again. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but in the same spirit. And there are a variety of chair movers, a variety of services, but the same Lord. Now, I didn't use this scripture against you. I just want to, if you have time, Brother Dean mentioned Wednesday not having service. I said, "Dean, we messed up. We messed up, my brother. We planned a little too far out and didn't think this thing through enough." We will have service Wednesday, but it will be you here serving. We're going to start at 3 and hopefully be done between 5 and 6 o'clock, getting these chairs out, in, moved, out there, unloaded, and undone. So if any of you, women, men, children, there's a couple guys coming bringing trailers. I'm going to bring a trailer. We're going to try to haul them. We're going to try to make it as quick and painless as possible. We'll probably have a little bit of refreshments here just for us to hang out and fellowship. Bring your children if they're over this big. If they can pick up one of these chairs and they listen. If they can't pick up a chair and they don't listen, we don't have childcare here Wednesday. But if they're this big and they can pick up a chair, you can bring them. If they're this big and they refuse to pick up chairs, drop them off at Nana's and y'all come on. This week will be a week of construction, so there won't be a lot of hanging out here at the church. This floor will be totally ripped out and redone. There's some other things going on, so there's going to be a lot going on. Can I tell you this? There's nothing more exciting. When I'm not here for a week, there's an angst inside of me that misses you. I miss just the community of being together. It ain't this. I'm not talking about preaching. I'm talking about just the seeing people and seeing lives, because it's something about walking through this room and looking into people's eyes and saying, "Wow, can't believe what God's done. Man, it's amazing what God's done. Man, I can't believe, how do we even know each other? You're not even from here. And look at what God's done. Man, it's amazing how our paths crossed. I never would have thought that I'd have a cousin from Texas. I mean, how did this happen? God's, you know what I mean? I mean, just looking around the room. I mean, I'd have never known a guy that is like family to me, because two of his parents met, his mom met my uncle, and we become family when we 30 years ago, 35 years ago. How did that happen? And I look around and see the miracles in people's, look at what salvation's done. Look what healing's doing. Look what God's doing. Look what God's doing. Miss Cheryl was in ICU 10 days ago. The atmosphere is changing. The atmosphere is changing. So I miss you. All right, time starts. We're on. John chapter 11. John chapter 11. Some of you read your Bible before, you're like, "I know what he's going to preach on." This is the story of Lazarus. This is the story. I'm just going to lay it out there for some of you that's going to be like, try to tune out because you know the Easter tradition deal. This is the story of Lazarus. This is the story of resurrection. This is the story where Jesus said, "I am the resurrection." So we are going to hint around those, but I have a little bit of different of a tag that I want to approach us with pre-Easter, the week before Easter. Now, I want to tell you this. I told the Bible study this. This is the week you get an Easter card. Jesus gives you one. This Easter card is, it don't matter, Chris, if you've asked them to come to church with you 100 times in the past, and they say, on Easter, you get to ask them again. You get an Easter card at your work, your mama, your cousin, your sister, the people that think the church will fall in if they come, you get an Easter card. You take it with you all week. Just hold your hand like this right now. Put your thumb and finger together. There's a card in there. All right, don't worry about it. We'll do it later. But this is your Easter card. You get to tell somebody, "Man, Jesus died for you." We're going to celebrate that this Sunday at church. You should come and see. Come and see. You remember when Jesus found the disciples in the beginning of Matthew? He walked out and found one, and they must have been looking for him, because then that brother went and got his brother and said, hey, we found the one we've been looking for. Come follow him. And he goes and gets Peter, and Peter comes back and finds Jesus, and they go back out, and they go to Nathaniel and Philip, and he said, hey, and he said, what? Where? Nothing good can come from there. And he says, come and see. Come and see. He think that if you want to. Come and see. So this Easter, you tell him, come and see. I don't know what you know about him. I don't know what you think about him. I don't know what happened in your past. And I don't care what you do the night before. I want you to show up Sunday and come and see what he won't do in your life. So do you get? There's your Easter card, okay? Use it. Use it, because God's going to do something. I'm telling you, we've seen transformation on Easter Sundays, especially when we're doing baptism. When we combine those two things, something powerful happens. And there's been people's lives transformed in this room that have never left since then, because they can't get away from him, because God's so miraculous. Now, John chapter 11, I want to read to you verses 25 and 26. I'm going to set the stage for you. You know this story. This is where Jesus was up downtown and or around town or up the street. And there was a family of his that were his friends. It was Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. I'm not exactly sure how they got so close, but the Bible says that he loved them and they loved him. Just introduce you to these people. Mary is a worshiper. She loves the Lord. She probably likes to take things, it sounds like, from the scriptures and just really mull over them and just be at his feet and just spend time with him and kind of, God, tell me more. Tell me more. Martha is, I believe Martha might be my mom or Ann or somebody. Martha's the one that's like, what do you want me to do? And do what? And I want to talk to you about some things. And I got some questions. And how do you do this? And whatever. And so, and then Lazarus, we don't know much about him except for Jesus wept because he said he loved him and he was raised from the dead. So, but there's this family. And so this story is wrapped around that family. And Jesus is down the road and they send word and say, hey, your friend that you love is sick and dying. Would you come? Jesus sends back and says, tell him I'm on the way. I'm coming. He don't leave. I was talking to Jack earlier before service, and we was talking about this scripture a little bit, and he said, man, this scripture's so complex. And then he preached a mini sermon, and I tried to preach a mini sermon, and he'd rather hear his than mine. So he finished. I'm just kidding. And we were just like, yeah, and this, yeah, and that. And he was like, yeah, and this, yeah, and that. And we were just back and forth talking about different things in this scripture. So we don't have time to do all of those justice today. I am going to provoke to you one sentence in this that's going to, I believe, transform your life. So Jesus waits a few days, shows up 4 days later. Brother's dead. Funeral's done. He's in the grave. The Bible says that his body probably even stinketh. If you don't know what stinketh means, it means stink. Stinketh is Hebrew for stinks. I'm just kidding. It's not. but the Bible says that his body already stunk. And Jesus shows up and says, what's going on? So I want to read this to you and let's talk through this conversation. And I may bounce around on these scriptures just to put some context in it. Matter of fact, I am. Now when Jesus came, verse 17, I know they're mad at me. They don't like me, but they're... Verse 17 says, now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. So he waited more than that. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, right? Mary's still in the kitchen or in the bedroom. Somebody says, Jesus is coming. God. Martha's like, we got to talk. Watch. Martha said, so when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him. But Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Now, I know the next verse to you want to read, but even now, how many of you have ever seen, what's the new show? Not The Passion, but The Chosen. I hadn't watched like the whole thing. Robbie's a faithful follower. Christy is. they've sent me clips before, and I watch those clips. I like watching clips. It's hard for me to watch things that I know what's kind of going to happen, and I'm already playing it out for them, but I do like watching the clips. But if I could make a clip of this one, and there may already be one, I may be rerunning it, but if I could make a clip of this, this is how I believe this went down. Martha came out of the house. Somebody come in and said, "Hey, Martha, Jesus is coming. So amazing. He came." All the Jews and stuff are there consoling. They're in there crying, eating black-eyed peas, cornbread. "You want some more onions with your cornbread?" Da, 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 da. And somebody comes in and says, "Martha, Mary, Jesus is here. He's here." And Martha says, she's probably back here sitting down. And she says, "What?" "Yeah, Jesus, he's here. I want to speak with him." She walks up to Jesus and says, "Lord," I don't believe she says, "Lord, Lord, Lordy, Lordy." I think she walks up and says, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." I'm looking for somebody. This won't be real awkward. Robbie, come here for a second. We've been awkward before. And I believe Robbie's the Lord, much more like the Lord. I'm much more like Martha. So, and I believe Martha says, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." And this is what I believe happened. Without everything in me, the only thing that could have changed that posture and the heart of this lady is his response. You watch what he does. The next verse, next sentence, he never says a word, and her mindset changes. What do you think happened? The embrace of him. I believe that he drew near to her and said, "Martha," and never had to say a word. I don't know if you've ever been there. I don't know if you've ever been to a family or to a lost loved one. You don't run in there and say, all right, guys, everybody, I got a scripture for everybody. Gather around. Everybody that's lost a loved one, your mama just passed, come on in, guys. I want to talk to you. No, you walk into the room and you're just like, "Hey, how are y'all doing?" And most of the time, they're like, "Pastor." I'm not being funny. It's exactly how it'll go. I don't know if you've ever lost a mama or a grandmother or an aunt or a sister or a son or a daughter. But normally, before you can say anything, and they're just, it's ugly crying. When you don't care and there's a little bit of snot and they'll still hug you, it's on your shirt. Really. And you don't say, "You're white." You don't talk about COVID. There ain't no mask or any of that in there. And that's what happened. "Jesus, if you would have been here, my brother wouldn't have died." Do you hear what's in that comment? The faith to say that if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Do you know what she's saying? That you could have transformed this situation, but you wasn't here. So her faith is strong because she's more faithful than most of us. It's easy to point at her and say, "How dare her speak to him? I wouldn't say a word. I wouldn't even dare." Please. There ain't a person in this room ain't questioned God. There ain't a person in this room hadn't said, "Why me? Why now? I don't think, why did this? I don't deserve this. What did I do to deserve this?" And you ain't looking at him. You know what you do to get those measuring sticks? You look around. Look at her. Look at him. Look at them. Look at that. 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 You're looking all around. "Look, I'm taller than him. I'm taller than him. Right there at him. I'm almost doing it." So she says, "If you would have been here," what she's saying is, "I had so much faith in you. I had so much belief in you. I thought that you would come the minute I called you. I thought, and if you got here, this situation would not be like this." And I love his response. He says nothing. It's the same Jesus on the cross when it says he spoke not a word. And her heart shifts and says, "But even I know that you'll raise him up on the last day." I don't believe Jesus said a word. This is total conjecture. But I believe in the middle of that comment, in the weeping, The Bible doesn't say she stays standing. I don't know how emotional some of you are. I've been around some people, and I've been around some of you. It's very likely, this conjecture, that Martha could have fell and been yelling and screaming. It's very likely that she could have just been broken. It's very likely she could have just been bland, calloused, hard, cold, numb by the fact that she lost her brother. And Jesus, conjecture, believes, and I know that you say, I don't care about what you think, Pastor. I don't know what the Bible says. I'm using references from the Scripture, how He moves on the broken. This is how He moves on the broken, is how why I believe what I believe about what probably happened here. And I believe Jesus moves towards her in the lack of her, in her hurt, in her pain. Not the lack of faith, not the lack of belief, because the Bible says that she, out of her mouth, said, you could have done this. I believe in you. I believe in your power. I know that you're the Son of God. I know that you have this transforming power. And she runs to him, and then he moves closer. And then she says, but even God, now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said, and we don't have complete time, but I want to just provoke you, and we'll be here around this next Sunday. He said, but even now, I mean, Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Whole reason we're here, right? Resurrection. Whole reason we're here. Martha's mindset is like most of ours. Okay, okay. So he'll go, so he's going to heaven, right, God? So you're saying, so okay, okay. Your brother will rise again. And Martha said, I know, Jesus, that he'll rise again. That's not really what I'm asking for. I was asking for you to come and him not have to go there. But I understand what you're saying. I know that he'll rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said, I am the resurrection. You know what day? Today. What he just said is, your brother is not going to resurrection. The resurrection came to your brother. Now, hold on. You got to remember, we're still talking about a dead man. And it's going to get more complicated, so don't think this gets easier. Because he's about to say something. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. Now, at this point, nobody's ever been resurrected from the dead. Though he die, yet shall he live. Martha's like, yeah, that's kind of what I was saying. Watch the next. It says, comma, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said, yes, Lord, I believe you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. And the next thing Martha does was, let me go get Mary. Because this has just got heavy. Now, the one sentence I want to highlight today, because next Sunday's Resurrection Sunday, and I'm just provoking you to come back. Today I want to talk to you on verse 26. He said, everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Now, Christianity in America has taught us, do you believe? Yes, I believe. You're going to heaven. Right here, he's telling Martha, he asked her a different question. He said, Martha, I want to tell you something. everyone who lives and believes statement shall never die. Do you believe this? Everyone who lives and believes. So what he's saying is, he said, I am the resurrection. Meaning, I am here. You are here. This belief system should provoke you to living in resurrection, not believing just for the resurrection. This is what I was talking about at the beginning of service when you come in needing a hospital. I believe Brother Lazarus needed an emergency room. And I don't know if these type emergency rooms would help him. He needed a hospital. He needed something serious. He came in a bad situation. Jesus showed up and found him in the bad, bad situation. Anybody ever felt dead? Like, I don't even want to get up. This is so bad. This is so terrible. I don't even care. I don't even know. I don't even know. I don't even. And Jesus shows up. He finds him in a really bad situation. And he shows up in that situation and he says, I am the resurrection to those that live and believe. Church, the challenge to us, to Martha, was to live and believe. The Lord's Prayer says, and let the things that are in heaven be on earth. He didn't say, let the people that are on earth be in heaven. I've told you this before. If Jesus' goal was to just get you to heaven, so I don't know if you know this, and this is a little complicated, and we definitely don't have time, but the Bible says he's coming back. This earth will not be the enemy's. Nothing he created does he hand over and say, oh, you know what? You pretty much wasted it. You can have it. There will be a new heaven and a new earth. He will take this thing and make it the way it's supposed to be. The Bible says that there'll be seeds that'll produce more harvest than ever before. He's going to reproduce what he's already produced. He's going to, by the power of his hand, what did we say earlier in that song? The atmosphere is changing. You think he's bringing more dirt? He's not going back up right here. All right, drop it. Okay, we're going to need 900 trillion more loads of that because I'm bringing new soil in everywhere. That's not what's going to happen. You know what's going to happen? The atmosphere is going to change because he's going to step foot on the ground and there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. So what's happening here is everybody's looking for that ticket there. And what Jesus is saying is the ticket came to earth. There is now resurrection power on this earth. And this power is available to you today. That's what he was making to Martha. This is going to be about Lazarus. I'm going to get to Lazarus. We're going there. But right now, let's talk about me and you. This conversation, Martha, do you believe this? Martha says, I know you and I know you came from God. And do you want to see Mary? I want to get Mary real quick because she can't wait to see you. She's been praying and all that, and I've been fussing and complaining. And I was wondering if you want to talk to Mary. Because I want Mary to talk to you because I don't really know what to say now. You've just taken my situation, and we don't have it a couple minutes. How many of you are holding your situation so tight right now? You can come in here, and the worship songs are great, and then your situation. You can come in here, the fellowship is great. Somebody reads a scripture, and you're like, man, that's so powerful. That's so powerful. And it feels like there's these two worlds in you. You know, Jonathan spoke last week about the way, these different ways they are. You know, John 14, he says, I am the way. In John 7, seven chapters earlier, half of that, he comes back and says, there's a way that's kind of narrow. And there's a way, that, and now don't many people take that way. And there's a way that's kind of wide. Jonathan done a great job expressing that. And he says, this way, and I told Jonathan afterwards, I said, you know, the kind of nugget that I take from that whole scripture and everything that you said and everything the Bible says is, this way don't look like me. It looks like you, and everybody don't want to go that way. Because this way is all about him. This way is about me pressing off myself and going just after you. It's only about you. If you look in that book, this is part of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, 7. Jesus is talking to his disciples for one of the first times and kind of get laying the groundwork, the foundation of what's going to go on. In Matthew chapter 7, there's, I think there's three different things of two. There's the two ways, the two trees, and the two houses. Remember? There's two ways you can go. There's two trees. There's two trees that's planted. One of them bears good fruit. One of them bears bad fruit. You don't walk up to a tree and say, I don't like you, tree. Or I think you're a bad tree. You look around the tree and you see what kind of fruit. There's two different houses that can be built. Let me just tell you something. In your life today, there's two different things going on. There's the flesh and the spirit. You know why that house was easier to build on the sand? How many of us ever dug a footing? Not like equipment digging footings. I'm talking about like 30 years ago footings. I didn't grow up around construction. My granddad was a mechanic. A buddy of mine started building a couple houses. I was about 18, probably 1995, 94. And he said, man, we can make $1,000 digging footings. With a shovel and a pick? I mean, back then a shovel and a pick was $25 for both, not each. And I said, I'm in. He said, house ain't about 1,400 square foot. So what you would do is back then they had to dig a 12 by 16. Wasn't it, Chris? 12 by 16, something like that. So you'd dig something about 16 inches wide, 12 inches deep, vice versa, whatever it was. And you just went around the perimeter of the house, the boards, and you dig it and throw that dirt over out of there, and then they'd pour concrete right there, and that held the house. Well, where you didn't want to go dig a footing is dirt that hadn't been bothered. You wanted to find a lot where it had to bring dirt in and pack that dirt with a little roller or a little truck or something, because that dirt came back out real quick. If you got to a place, the first footing we dug, I was like, oh, they need a little dirt. He said, yeah, they got dirt. We dug it about lunch. We was like, whew. You know, you're 18. You want to see how fast you can dig. I'm sweating, shirts off. You know, I didn't even wear a shirt until I was 30. But no shirts on, you know what I mean? Back then, everybody wore, now boys are wearing shorts like that again. But we, our shorts were right here, and they was cut off. And you know what I mean? You're out there, a pair of boots on. Just two men. You know what I mean? There's something wrong with alpha males. You're just, what? Can you lift more? Yeah, I think I can. Do it again. Okay. Put more on there. Oh, it hurts. Do it again. Okay. And so just two men out there sweating, looking at each other. It's crazy what we'd do. Just digging. So the second time he called me, I was like, man, this is going to be so cool, dude. I'm making $600 by lunch. I've never done this before in my life. I wasn't making half that in a week. We get out there. 3 days. The pick went. Oh, God. I said, let's start on the other corner. We'll work our way back to that. Okay, let's go to the other corner. We'll work our way back to that. The whole way around the house. And that day, you didn't quit. But there wasn't near the excitement. We wasn't throwing dirt. He's like, oh, that's stupid, man. That's stupid right here. And what Jesus is saying, there's a way. There is a way that may seem right to a man to go build your house on some sand and go over there and go, and just throw all the dirt and they say, no, pour that concrete, man. We're ready for the concrete truck by 2 o'clock. Got a rebar down. Face in, wires in, got to poly down, pour that thing. We ready. It seems right. Seems right. But that scripture is, times are going to get tough. You know what makes that way narrow? It's because when times get hard, you don't get to do what you want to do. That's what I was saying earlier. When God's called you to do a certain thing and he asked you to give and you gave $100 and your power bill was $250, you're $100 short. You're like, what? 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 And it seems kind of... And then he shows up. Some of you stepped into something or walked away from something. You're like, what's going on? I don't really know what to do. This is not the way I would have chose. It starts off with just driving. Before somebody cuts you off, you're like, ha, 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 ha. Right? I don't know if any of you get that, but my life is every road I drive on is a race. It's not because I like driving race cars, just in my life. Since I was a kid, I just pass people. Somebody's in front of me, I feel like they're winning. I'm like, mm-hmm. My wife, everywhere we go, every time we're in the car, she said, baby, what are you doing? We're on vacation. We have no time to be anywhere. Why are you doing that? I was like, I rode with my son-in-law's brother. We went on 4 different police stops. We never broke the speed limit. I looked over at him on the second one. I said, like, Gulf Shore Police, y'all don't break the speed limit? Are we not going to and pull somebody over? He said, no, they really don't like us to do that because it draws so much attention. I was like, well, can we go down another road? Can we go? We go over to Orange Beach and break their rules? Is it somewhere we can go? But it's just that. Some of you think I'm crazy, don't you? I am. I feel like I'm crazy sometimes. But you got that thing. And But what happens is when you're out of control, or when you lose that and you go, everybody's doing that. Everybody's driving like that. Everybody's acting like that. Everybody's doing like that. Everybody looks like the whole church is doing that. What, am I going to be the only one doing this? The way's narrow. And I will tell you, more people will cross from them wide lanes and come over when they see you walking this path. And it looks like, man, I seen that dude. Man, he said this. And the next thing I know, he was at the altar. And he ain't said that in 3 months. I wonder what guy. Man, it looked like he crossed over. There's just a different way. And today, you can come on, Shelly. They're coming to help me. They anoint me at the end of service. And I was thinking about Jonathan's message last week and what the Lord was saying to us about the different ways and thinking about what God was doing in me this week. And I know we tried to condense a lot by telling you thank you and kind of interjecting what's going to be going on this week, and because it's so important for us to be able to. And I just want to tell you something. It's not a fact of if this is going to get done if you don't come and don't feel the pressure. It's not that. I'm just telling you, there's something about coming and being in community. You will feel different. This ain't like this. It's just different. I can't explain it to you. It's just different when you're fellowshipping with other brothers. And listen, if you're having a bad day and you're feeling terrible and you're going to come in here and you might cuss somebody out if you have to move one more chair, don't come. Don't come, because then me and you's going to be in the office. You're going to be like, man, I just don't know, man. I'm going to be like, man, you can't do that. What are you doing? You should have just went and got you something to eat, man, went home. You know what I mean? Built a fire or something. But there's just something about when God's provoking you and saying, you know what? I want to do something inside of you. I want to keep you. There's just something about God whenever he shows up in the middle of the mess and says, I am the resurrection. There's like 7 I am statements in John, and this is the most powerful one. And a couple years ago, we did that little series where we talked about the I am the bread, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the resurrection. So, the powerful point of this scripture to me . I love that Jesus is the resurrection, but the approach that he takes to invite you to that resurrection is the deal breaker or deal maker. He don't yell back. He don't jump up and prance around. He says, Martha, I am the resurrection. I am. I'm what you needed 4 days ago. I'm what you needed last week when he had a fever. I'm what you needed. I'm going to be what you need today. I'm what you need tomorrow. all the laws and the, do you understand the Ten Commandments, the laws, the rules, all of those things? When Jesus said, I came to fulfill those, he was coming to say, all of those things that you need, I am. He was coming to say, all that hurt and pain and bitterness, and I am. All those things, those Ten Commandments that showed you that you were less than and you couldn't make it and you wouldn't pull it off and you couldn't, every time you tried, he said, I am. So what's powerful about that is, how many of you, when you take the Ten Commandments test, you fail every time? See, I told y'all, y'all more like me than you think. You're 0 for 10 every time. Nobody in here says, you know what? I passed the test. Just good on test. No. You fail every time. And he shows up right there, whichever, and he shows up and says, hey, I am the rest. Because you know what that'll do? You know what failure does? Knocks you down. Thou shalt not lie. Oh. Mm. Thou shalt not murder. Mm. Or even think about it. Oh. Thou shalt not covet your neighbor's thing. Mm. You can't even like that. You can't. You know what coveting is, right? When you're jealous because they got it. I'm like, they don't really deserve it. How did they get a brand new? I mean, I don't understand how they. I don't need no new car to show nobody what I got. I don't understand this right now. I live on. It's the same way when people say, I don't care if anybody likes me. They're the most insecure person in the room. I don't do this. I don't care. And they lie. So you start looking at these Ten Commandments, and what happens is you find yourself feeble or hurting or broken. Laura was singing a song earlier, and I've known her since she was a kid, and so I can sense her, and she's not like you. I pretty much say whatever to her, and so that's why we close. And so I just text her and said, that song you're singing is for you. And I don't have to worry about Laura saying, you don't really know my business, and I don't want you talking to me like that. No. Because I still might spank her. She might be too old, but I seen her tears in her eyes. And I could tell in her worship that she changed because she understood God's revealing himself to me in my worship. And I don't know what had happened before that. I didn't see her. I seen her for 1 minute when I walked out. When I walked in, I just know her. I could see it on her face. I didn't ask her what's going on. What's been going on with you? We need to talk. You need to tell me. I just felt, sensed it on her. Said, this worship's for you. You know why? Because in the middle of whatever's going on, was I right or wrong? You were dealing with something? That means, yeah, I can't look at her again because she'll start crying. That's what happens when you about raise somebody. So I just walk by her, and you know what happens? Is in the middle of that, singing a song, trying to do something that other people can worship, resurrection shows up. And he walks over there, and he says, I am the resurrection. I'm more than this song. I'm more than the key. I'm more than the words. I'm what you need. It's not a song. This is a worship. It's not a key. This is a worship. And then it just starts happening in you. And I guarantee you, from the time that I text her that till her sitting up here now, nothing's changed. I'm going to close with this. The end of this story is in this conversation. Lazarus is not raised. Martha comes up. Martha leaves and has to understand, I'm the resurrection, even if he don't get up. Did you hear me? He didn't say, Martha, go find Lazarus because he's up wandering around in the graveyard. It's not what he said. He just said, Martha, I am the resurrection. Martha had to go chew that. Martha had to go back and say, I don't even know what that means. So aggravated when he came. He didn't come. Then he shows up, and I can't even be mad at him. I don't even understand. I don't know what he means. He's a resurrection. Hey, though he lives, and he died, and if he dies, he lives. What is he talking about? I don't even get this. How do I walk this out? I don't understand. All I know is something's different. In his presence, I'm changed. That's all she knew, Mike, is for some reason. Do you see? Do you see at the end that she's not fussing anymore? She's not complaining. She's not saying, but you could, but will you still? But what about? She didn't say that. She said, I know. I understand you're the Son of God. And you can do whatever. I'm going to get Martha. Something happens in his presence. The atmosphere changes. Did you see the atmosphere? It shifted. Before the resurrection, physically, when the physical resurrection showed up, before Lazarus ever got up, the atmosphere changed. I mean, before the actual resurrection of Lazarus, Jesus weeps. Me and Jack was talking, he said, it shows his full humanity, don't it? Why would you be dealing with anything? Don't you know God's the resurrection? How could you let him? Shelly, how could you sing worship all the time and then deal with anxiety? Tim, I can't believe you got heart conditions and you believe in Jesus. This ain't even, what's going on around here? We're full humans. We're fully human, but full of belief. What did he say earlier? You got to live and believe. I'm going to tell you something. In life, it'll test your belief. If you don't learn to live and believe, that means I'm not waiting, Mr. Brown, on the ticket to the other side. I'm celebrating because the other side came over here. And now I have resurrected life. Let's stand to our feet and worship. I don't want us to be a church that waits till tomorrow, waits till the end of times. I don't want to talk about the resurrection. I want the resurrection power inside of me. I want to live and believe. The command to Martha was, you got to live and believe. I don't want you to say, I know Jesus. I understand who he is. The Pharisees do that. The demons do that. They confronted him and said, hey, we know who you are, and we know why you came. But they didn't change their lifestyle. You got to live and believe. I'm ready for a life change. I come every time I enter this sanctuary because, God, I want to live and believe. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Let me just tell you, I don't know what she's going through. I don't know what you're going through. You don't know what I'm going through. But I'm just going to tell you this. If I was just betting on the other side, I'd quit now. I'd get my ticket. I'd struggle through life. And hope I landed on the other side. I don't have a ticket over there, AJ. I got one for right here. I want to ride now. I'm at the fair. I'm at Six Flags. I want on the ride right now. I don't want to wait till this thing closes and you give me a free ride over to the other side. I want to play on the field right now. I want resurrection power in this room right now to where when we have service, when we show up on Sundays, when we gather together as a body of believers, when you go to work tomorrow, that resurrection power goes with you. When he showed up at that grave, you know what transformed everything, Alicia? Everybody that went believed resurrection's with us. Resurrection's with us. When they showed up, all the groundwork had been laid. They dug a foundation on a solid rock. They understood he showed up. He might be late, but he's right on time. And he already said, resurrection power, he's with us. So it was a different deal when they walked to the graveyard. I don't know if you've ever been to one. My mom and daddy's in one. So when you walk up there, it's like, man. All those memories of what didn't happen and what did happen and what got me to that spot and where I was at. And when I go there, and I'm always like, man. But when resurrection power lives, when I met Jesus, I quit worrying about what my dad didn't do and my mama didn't do and what they couldn't. I started saying, God, there is power. And you love them just like you love me. And that's your business if they're with you. And so now when I walk up there, it's a different deal because resurrection walks with me. Resurrection walks with me. For years before that, my grandmother would take me there and we'd cut grass. We'd pick weeds and we'd dust it off every two or three times a week. That's what we did. Their lots had to look immaculate. She kept them clean, put flowers on there every time, and we went there. We didn't know Jesus. We didn't know. Everything we thought was right there. I don't go there every week. I don't go there every week. It'll catch me a little mental sometimes, and I may go by there and just be in my feelings. I don't go. They ain't there. Now I could go by that graveyard. I go there all the time to do funerals. My mama and daddy's laying over there. Now my grandmother's laying with them. Everything I love, my cousin's laying there with my best friend. They all right there. All of them's laying right there together. Now when I walk in there, there's the resurrection. The power goes with me. I understand there's somebody else. They don't have to stay in that grave. Death don't have a sting. It don't hurt me like it did because I understand there is resurrection power inside of him. Amen? Let's sing.